Today, we have a wonderful guest, and her name is Lilo Mace, and she's the creator and the host, writer, and producer of the Juicy Living Tour, a wonderful video interview show on YouTube. She is also an author and journalist. And in the past, she's had her own inspirational TV show and has continued and expanded that with her Juicy Living Tour on YouTube. She travels all over the world interviewing people who are motivating and inspiring others, whether they are authors, healers, scientists, spiritual teachers, physicists, physicians, and the list appears endless. So far, she's done over 850 interviews and 1,700 videos. I don't know how she has the time to do all this. She gets over 1 million views a month and has over 14 million video views. Wow. It's amazing. Lilo's mission is to create and host an international communication network to inspire, motivate, and empower millions of people to pursue their dreams and to help spread joy, freedom, and personal awakening. So, Lilo, I want to welcome you to Kauai and to Transformational Tea.
Thank you, Taj. Okay, it's so good to be back here in Kauai. Thank you.
Oh, it's so great to have you. And you are amazing. You have an amazing amount of energy and vision to do all these things that you've done in your life that have led up to the Juicy Living Tour. But the first thing I want to ask you, did you have an experience or a role model or something that really pushed you into creating what you've created?
The big one was Oprah Winfrey. I went to the show and I saw the Oprah Winfrey show and I saw her just being there and interviewing people, and it felt, something really felt so good deep inside. It was a certain recognition of her soul, not how she looks like on the outside, mm-hmm. or her appearance or her wealth or the cameras or how famous she was, but really the work that she was doing on the planet. I recognized that on a deep level. I was speechless. I can't even say it. And it was such a wonderful moment. And from that moment on, there was this kind of light, and it was ignited in me, and I have never stopped since then.
Well, did you have thoughts that came in the way as you were doing it that you had to release? And I mean, because this is a big venture that you started on.
Yes, I had so many thoughts, and I really thought I was the worst communicator. I had fear of, still to this day, of public speaking, but at the time even of camera. I just couldn't understand why I felt so strongly passionate about wanting to interview people and do this, and it didn't make much sense to my rational, to mm-hmm. the mind. But in my heart, there's just this other level, this quiet voice, and this deep understanding that there was something there for me to really nourish me on a deeper level. My soul needed to do this. Mm-hmm. There was something there, and I just, one step at a time, then the fears came up. And I was stepping each time outside of the comfort zone, but each little step was a big step for me, and a big step towards the fulfillment of this dream.
So, and did the dream change? I mean, as you've done it, has it expanded or changed how it looks?
It started really from video blogging on YouTube to then starting to do Skype interviews, to start to interview people, oh my God, in person, and be in the intimacy of their eyes and their soul, to now traveling and doing this full time around the world. And now I'm back in Hawaii, and it's just, I feel so blessed to be doing my soul work, my soul purpose. I feel right on track. It's fulfilling. Right. I don't long for something else outside now.
So when you were first starting, were there people that didn't support what you were doing, that were like, no way, you can't do this, how are you going to make a living, how are you going to get connected to people with it? Was there any of that?
There's many, including my parents. My parents were just, I had to really protect this dream, and I was very careful as to, at some point, especially when stepping in it, because it was so big and I couldn't even really see exactly what it would look like myself. It was just a feeling place of, there was something I needed to share and communicate. So I just had to protect it. And I really just, I was conscious at the time enough to say, okay, I'm going to, this person, I know she will understand. This friend, that particular friend will be positive and supportive. She won't judge me or try to tell me the negative sides of it. So I was very much protecting it. Yeah, and many people, especially actually around us, our environment, are usually so loving us so much, they want to protect us from any challenges or problems or...
Yeah, and that's just what we were talking about. We weren't talking about the people around us, but they're the same way because they have the same fears that we do. Everyone's living in this consciousness of we want it. Mm-hmm. We know what it's like. We don't want you to go through it. We don't want you to feel pain. And children, you know, get that from their parents all the time, and they don't know it because they don't know that out in the world there's this pain that they shouldn't feel until their parents tell them.
Yeah, that's why it's very important, I feel, to have those conversations with our parents and complete our relationship with our parents so we can be our full human being and even cut those cords, those emotional cords, those stories in the past that could have harmed us or that we can, even if the parent is gone, you know, there's ways now to forgive. And with the Ho'oponopono, there's so many techniques to let go of the past. And there's some really powerful healers on the planet. And, and we have to find the one that corresponds exactly, that resonates in our heart, and then do the work. And the work is to be done now at this time. And it's easy to, we can do it really quickly now. If we put our heart in it and if we're really in integrity with it and aligned, then we can really heal fast. But we have to want it, because with big healing means big purpose, means fully being out there and open and vulnerable and authentic. So there's a lot that comes with it.
So how would you say that you evolved also as a person? You know, because each step of your journey, you were in one place, and as you did these things and felt more and more comfortable, you added more to yourself and to, you know, what you were doing. So if you could talk about maybe an incident or an experience that was pivotal in your getting catapulted on any moment of your journey of this, what would you would you say was inspiring besides the beginning one with Oprah?
The losing my job. I moved from the US to England to accept a position, because at the time I was doing videos on YouTube and I had already done some interviews and there was a couple of millions, and I thought there's definitely something there, but I still have to pay the bills and have a regular job. So I accepted this position of director of marketing in London. And 7 months into this, I lost my job. I was fired. I was made redundant, however you want to call it. But basically, I was out the door. And my ego was really, it was a big hard moment. And I had to do a lot of cleanup from that moment. So losing my job was a big opportunity to step in my purpose, because I wouldn't have had the guts otherwise. I wanted to make sure I would be doing it right. But frankly, the marketing was not anymore something that was suitable for me. And I knew it, but I hadn't catch up to it. It's kind of like life brings us to this path. And then all of a sudden we wake up, we're like, this is just not it. And so I became grateful. That's what my book is called, I Lost My Job and I Liked It, because I turned out to actually love the fact that I was free again. And then from there on, then my second book was I Had No Money and I Liked It, because I found myself with no more money at all, having to go back to my parents, really going through this whole phase of kind of humiliating, but I had to really clear up and detox and just really, okay, who am I if I'm not my job, my car, my this and that.
Right, and that's big. So at what point did you write the book while you were in it? Did you write the books after? At what point did you feel enough to be stepping away from it enough to be able to see it from that perspective, to write about it?
I was already in the process of doing video blogs on YouTube, because I was participating in something that I had created called the 100-Day Reality Challenge. So I was blogging about my life, and I already had seen the difference it makes once we speak out, when we dare to come out, when we dare even of speaking of our shadow side, and how much it frees us. So I immediately took my iPhone when this happens, from the moment I got fired, and I start recording. I thought it would be an interesting thing to record, to see, okay, which practice am I going to use? How am I going to change that energy, those fears that are going to come in? And so as I was recording, I was already kind of being with everybody that would read the book or hear it. And so that gave me the extra support and energy and the listening. And so it was kind of an ongoing process. The 30 days it's the recording basically of the 30 days after losing my job and stepping in my dream job.
So you were doing a reality show before reality shows,
yeah.
of your own, except recording it instead of videoing it. Yeah. That's pretty amazing. So the process of writing the book, how was that for you? Was it a cathartic experience as well?
No, everything really was, and I'm not saying, I still have a lot of work ethics, and I really, there's no limit for me in time. I would have a more tendency towards work alcoholism than anything else. So I do love and enjoy it so much. It's not even work, but I spend hours and hours.
Yeah.
But for the book, what was surprising is that I thought of it before of writing a book, so I really enjoy reading, and it didn't came on paper. So for me to talk about, to speak it, and to use the dictaphone or the iPhone and to record it by voice, and then have somebody type that, mm-hmm. and then work on that from that point was just a huge relief, and exactly my own expression. This is how it had to come out.
Right. That's great.
So then it wasn't really a daunting thing. Within a month or two, it was done. The second book was a longer process, but it's done the same way. I have recorded the full process of a year of really wanting to become a bestseller with the ego very much there to, okay, I have no more money, then to my heart reopening for the first time of my life to really see what it means to live in abundance every day and to see it everywhere and to recognize it in everything. And so my life has tremendously changed since 2009, 2010, and now I'm not living in this paradigm of fear of money or I am the money on my account and none of that.
Right.
And that's what I really want to bring to people. My book is coming out in France soon,
thrilled. The same book?
The same book is coming out only now in France, and we're just finishing up the cover and the inside, and it's so excited for me to bring it to my home country.
Yeah,
is so thrilling to have this conversation of no money and abundance. Oh my goodness!
Yeah. So, did you write your book in English?
The first one is
in English. Okay.
They're both in English, and then they're translated in French.
Okay, so just even that concept, though, from a French person to writing it in English to. Because there is such a difference of concepts from French to English, even though we think it's directly translating, it's not.
It's not, and I find English very much a language for the heart, and it's easy. There's so many words that they don't exist in France, or I just needed that permission in another language to express some things that were there, and it was harder in my native language. But now, with the years, I'm starting to really come out in French too and do a lot of videos and interviews in French. And I just know who I am now, and I have self-confidence and love. And so I can just step out fully, even in the rockiness and of the cultural intellect type of French culture.
Mm-hmm.
And I can just stand there and this is who I am. And this is wonderful feeling, so freeing.
It's so interesting how hard it seems at times to be in your homeland, even your home city, you know, to do what you do in your home city and not feel the barrage of pressure or judgment, and that it's easier to go out into the world to do what you do, and then eventually you come back home and everything's changed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's very powerful. So if people want to get to your book, now I know they can go to www.lilumace.com, that's LILOUMACE, to find out about what's going on with you, what your calendar is. They can go there also to find your book if they want to purchase it.
Yeah, yeah. The tour and the travels and the latest interviews are really on the juicylivingtour.com.
Mm-hmm.
But the books, yeah, they're on there, on Amazon or...
Oh, okay. Okay, so they can see that the book is there and then go on to Amazon if they want.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very inspiring. So
Thank you. What
about... I'm going to ask a really hard question here. So, because you've interviewed so many people, and I'm not going to say which is the one interview that was, you know, the greatest, but there are, like, maybe a stream of thought that really affected you. It might not be one interview. It could have been 50. But that stream that took you from one state into this state of feeling confident of yourself or, you know, whatever it is for you, What line was that, or what was the stream that really seemed to, even if it was an interview, that really transform you?
Well, each time I have been asked that question, the answer is different, of course, depending on the context. And you were speaking earlier of the fear and of death and all that. And I've been extremely inspired lately by near-death experiences, including the one of Anita Moriani that has become a very famous near-death experience. And she had cancer grade 4B lymphoma, had 36 hours to live. She went through this near-death experience that she describes in her book, Dying to Be Me, that is published with A House. And then she describes the unconditional love that she felt, the choice that she had, the full awareness that there was just no time, that she could go from one place to the next. And I feel all those are just so amazing life lessons. Mm-hmm. And she realized that she was just living a life of fear, and that's what had created her cancer. Her cancer was because of her fear of cancer, of not eating right, of living with those thoughts, of continuously battling. And then she went through it, and she was able to liberate herself from that during this near-death experience that lasted. She was in coma, and it lasted for, I don't know, hours. Mm-hmm. And then she came back, and she, within 4 days, she was totally healed. And she had, like, tumors of the size of limes,
wow.
21 in her full body. She was suffering wow. so much. I mean, this is a big case. And Dr. Wayne Dyer, after interviewing him in Maui last year, he introduced me to Anita. And I finally met Anita after all those amazing Skype interviews that we had in person 2 weeks ago in Glasgow, in Scotland. Great. And it was just so delicious to see her. And she has such a powerful message. I know a lot of people on the island have read already this story, and the YouTubes are going around, because I feel near-death experience are our doorway, even though if we don't live a near-death experience, by listening or reading to one, we're affected by that vibration. Mm-hmm, we
definitely.
Feel it. There's something that shifts in us. And I think one of my next book is actually will be on near-death experience or compilations of thoughts. Because then I had the opportunity to interview Dr. Raymond Moody, that wrote Life After Life in 75. It's been a rippling effect of wonderful stories. And to me right now, those are the interviews I'm very passionate and inspired by. Yeah.
Well, it's so interesting, because one of the ways that actually people can have their own, not near-death experience, but experience, if you believe this, is to do hypnosis and to experience the life mm-hmm. between lives, and to really
yes.
see, and you can experience it, can be a tangible experience of your own, of knowing that there's more
mm-hmm.
than beyond what it is. And there are lots of books that
yeah.
of people talking, even if it's just stories through hypnotherapy, of like the lives between lives. It's so powerful when you have your own experience
mm-hmm.
more than reading it.
Yeah, and that's when I want to put not a warning, but I really do some of those videos right now to really say to people, just please really feel inside your heart who you're going to do this with. Do that with a person
right.
that you trust, that feels right. Like, to me, you're a wonderful healer. You're somebody I would trust, I would do hypnosis with, I would do this work with. It's very important to not just do that from fear-based, and not because that person just showed up in our life.
Right.
It's more than that. It is your life. It is your karma. It is your dharma. It is actually a big deal, even though if it's fun and playfulness.
Yeah,
so
it's
choose
a very big
who
deal.
You're going to put your, and I really put some warnings now, because I see that this is important, and we're the gurus is inside, it's not
that's
outside
right.
So just listen to this voice and move forward.
Yeah, that's really important, because it's all about feeling connected
yeah.
and trust. Well, and that's the whole thing. This everything in life is about trust.
Yes.
Trusting that inner voice, trusting, you know, what you're really feeling, not someone that's telling you this is the right thing.
Mm-mm.
Like there's no teacher out there that can tell you something that you can't tell yourself.
Mm.
Yeah.
It's really important to listen to our hearts and that voice. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
trust, and just move forward if it feels just right. And even though if it can be scary because of the it's a new experience, or it's going to be something different and we don't know what it's going to look like, that's something else. But I'm talking of the fear of just the pressure that can happen sometimes, or the just do it now. Or
right.
if there's a tiny little bit of fear or doubt, just don't do it. It's not your time yet. You don't
right.
know when it's your time.
Right. So you were here a year ago, and to me, I just seeing you, just looking at you, your energy is different. You feel really grounded and just softer in so many different ways. Anything amazing happened in the last year to you?
An amazing man entered my life about
wow.
a year ago.
Wow.
Actually, a year ago.
And were you wanting that to happen, or was that just like an extra frosting on the cake of what you've been doing?
Well, I was on the Juicy Living tour. I had spent 2-3 months in Hawaii meeting amazing people, meeting the dolphins, which has definitely made a change in my life. Oh. That has really softened. That was a big part of the transformation, I think, coming to Hawaii.
Right.
And meeting these beautiful beings.
And what's your experience with the dolphins been? What, like,
how
do you feel it's affected you?
Multi-dimensional, beautiful, just love, embracing. I felt my feminine side open because of this experience. I felt they taught me how to just be, and we didn't need to do anything else. We just could be in there. We could just walk in life, and we really didn't have nothing to do. The rest was extra because we really felt empowered to do some things. But it's been such a healing experience, and I was dolphinized. I think I really did those videos where I had tingling eyes, and it's really something happened there. And last year in August, for my 34th birthday, I felt really, you know, blessed, and I said, my goodness, I'm so blessed to be living on purpose, to do a job that I love, to travel the world, interview people. And I said, if I don't meet a man, if I don't live if I don't have kids, if I don't have the house, all of that, it doesn't matter really, because I'm on purpose. And within a month, I go back to France just for 2 weeks, because I had been traveling nonstop for already 8 months. And when I came back, within a week or so, I met Hugues. And it's been just his dual citizenship, and he had lived in Canada for half of his life, and he had 2 kids and a wonderful home exactly where I wanted to live in France. So here I was in this, you know, how we say, we think sometimes we're a little bit late, and the kids were there, his 2 kids, 9 and 12, the man, this amazing man, and the house, and all of it.
And you get it all.
And I just jumped in that life. So now now I'm on the Juicy Tour Europe, and I spend time with him, and then I go back to a European country, and then I go back to France, and then to another country, and my life is different than last year, but it's certainly been a huge blessing. And I feel once we meet somebody we're supposed to meet, there's so much healing on so many levels that I never had wanted to face before.
Right, because relationships bring up so much from the past.
Yeah, and it was too much before. Honestly, all relationships were just failures because I wasn't ready to face that. I was pushing them away. I was saying, no, thank you. It's too painful. I'm not ready for this. Mm-hmm. So it had been a disaster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so what we were talking about earlier, what I started the show with, was about the fear of death. And when you move into the present, your life completely changes, and the projects actually don't even matter. An achievement doesn't matter at all, because every day you're just doing what you're doing. And how it's going to look in the end, or who's going to see it in the end, I mean, when you go, and none of that really matters. It's the moment to moment, can I be love, can I be kind? And even if you can't, that you're okay to live alongside that fear, having it, knowing that it's there, and you can be angry or happy and still be in the moment. You know, that's very powerful.
Yeah, and Ram Dass, I just came back from Maui and interviewed Ram Dass. It was really an honor to meet him, and I immediately felt his presence. And he's 81 now, he's on a wheelchair, and he says actually his stroke was grace. And to arrive to this place where you're able to recognize that whatever we go through is grace.
Yes.
It's, it was a big lesson just looking at his eyes, and when he says, and he could just be there in his heart, and he dropped there in full awareness. It's just, whoa. I was getting it through him. And I think as we're present ourselves, this is the gift that we give, as dolphins give, then we emanate that unlimited and this space and this juiciness, that it's nearly palpable. We're talking about that, how palpable it is. It becomes so potent, that love, you know, and it's yummy.
Because when you have that love inside of yourself, you know, and the nature, this is the most beautiful thing that you're saying, is that nature is reflecting the way that we are meant to live. So in joy and happiness, and how do you feel when you're with the dolphins? I was swimming with them yesterday. And it was so amazing. And this one came up, I was on my board, and this one came up, and it was like 2 feet from the board and completely stopped and then flicked its tail and just zoomed off. And it was so funny. It was like it looked at me and just kind of laughed. And and this living in the present, I mean, how could I plan that that would happen? How could I plan to feel that way? But in each of those moments when we just are that way, when we just know that every moment is a gift, every moment, every challenge is a gift to take us deeper into who we really are, into staying connected to that divinity that we are, or that higher self that we are, that that being that we are, right? And then we're able to give so much more. And then we let go of all that stuff that's about us and do what you're doing, which is assisting people on the planet to come into that place of love.
Yeah, and I wish that really for everybody, to connect with their hearts and just not worry whether we will love in a goofy way anyway, and it's okay. And is really beautiful when we start to give ourselves the chance to love again deeply, ourselves and others. But and it's powerful. Love is powerful too. You know, we often say it's not just this lovey feeling and just walking, because love is powerful and take actions and say no also. And
it's my
heart desire that everybody wakes up to this power of love and not just being in this spacious woo-woo space.
Romantic, really blissful love.
Blissful love also, but just like really getting there and being out there and shining out.
Right. Well, because love, if you look at it from, when you step back and not look at it from a person-to-person perspective, but as an energy, the energy of love that emanates from each one of us towards another, towards the planet, towards the galaxy, it has nothing to do with romantic love. It's so much bigger and it's so much deeper than that. And that's just sending that support to another without any agenda is so powerful.
And gratitude is a step to that, because
that
if we're grateful, if we don't know really what love is, because it could be, for me at least, it was confusing and I was afraid to love, so I didn't know really what that felt like. And gratitude is a step towards that.
Definitely.
And then we can it can go deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into love, intense love. But it's all love.
It's all love. Even forgiveness is a big, huge part.
Oh my goodness.
That's the biggest
it's
key.
It's an access, yeah.
That is, it's like a little portal that opens us into this huge, endless cave of love.
Feels good.
Yeah. So what do you have coming up that's wonderful?
Well, I'm heading back to, well, I'm going to Oahu for the Quantum Medicine Congress. Dr. Imoto will be here in Honolulu in not too long, in a few days.
I think it's October 4th to October 7th.
So it's sold out, I think, unfortunately. Okay. But it will be there. I think they're broadcasting it, and I'll surely interview most of the speakers there, so
great.
We won't miss a bite.
Great.
And I'll share that on YouTube. But and then I'll go to France on October 8th. And then I will I'll be going to Marseille and to Toulon, south of France. Ama is going there.
Oh, great.
And I'll be having an interview with Ama.
Really?
Yes. And
it doesn't happen very often, an interview.
Yeah, but it happens that one of the person on her team really loves and enjoys my videos, and she thought it would be a wonderful moment.
It will be,
yeah.
Great.
And then there is the rest of Europe and Eastern Europe. I'm very excited to go to Eastern Europe. And I still have to do Italy, Spain. I really enjoyed Scandinavia. There's just, it's an ongoing list. It all depends. I just really follow the flow too. And I have some certain dates, but most of all, it's being guided by the different events or the people and the emails and the feedback and how I feel in my heart too. And I just then book the flight and go.
Right. So you're in the flow.
Yes. So there's no big plans. It's just opening up. There is big plans, yes. But it's just opening up and unfolding.
Yeah. And so you assisted so many people by having these shows on the air, by interviewing these people that we would not have access to, you know, unless you read their books. And a lot of the people you've interviewed, they have no books. They don't. Maybe they have a website. Maybe they don't. So the exposure, even what I found is that even the exposure of watching a person can open you up. Mm-hmm. It's so amazing. You don't have to talk to them. You don't have to read their book. Sometimes just being in the field mm-hmm. of that person, even through, you know, the computer, can be so powerful and unlimited.
Mm-hmm. And that's why each time before I start the interview, most of the time I say, and sometimes I don't because it's I feel that the space is already there. But if it's not, I would really ask my guest to be in the present moment and that we have a heart-to-heart conversation. And I need to look at their eyes to connect, because if they have glasses, or it's harder, I feel. And connect to their soul and be really present and know that it's beyond the words. It's our energy and mm-hmm. what we emanate. And then that heals, yes, the people that watch and even just doing it.
I think so. When you hold the intention that you have held, every step of the way becomes a walking meditation.
Yeah.
And in that meditation and in that stillness, even though it doesn't feel like stillness, mm-hmm. you're allowing other people to go into that same place themselves.
Yeah.
And that's where healing happens.
Yeah. And for me, I'm very much an active person. So my challenge is to just slow down and sometimes not feel guilty for being on Kauai and laying down in the sun, which haven't happened yet. I've been a week in Hawaii and didn't even take the time. And I do this more and more and more often, because I know that it's not about the doing and just to the list. And I've been really good at that, at slowing down and at planning more ahead, and that just really then therefore really be there with the people and not just halfway. So it's a learning experience.
Yeah, so you're getting as much as well. You know, you're getting the experience yourself.
Yeah. Oh my goodness, it's such a blessing. Yeah. We live in extraordinary times. I can't believe it.
Yeah.
And it's accessible to all of us.
It
is. It's not just for some people, oh, it's great. I mean, I was meeting, and you've interviewed her. It was Jump for Joy.
Oh, I know, Iola.
She's making it, and I'm so supportive, and she knows. And if you're listening to this, you know how much I support you. Oh, my goodness. It was great. I saw her vibe. I saw her energy, and I recognize this. I mean, it's exactly that. You don't exactly know how it's going to turn out or how it's going to look like and how it's going to really, you're going to make a living from it or whatever, but it just unfolds.
That's right.
From the moment you're living it. You just dare to live it. And
it happens all around you.
Yeah.
I know, it's so great.
Yeah, so it's really accessible. It's not just this thing out there for somebody else, but not me. If you feel that it's not for you, then there's just some love and healing work to do and to embrace that part of you that is scared, and then something else will come up from there.
And it's important to, as you said in the beginning, to really bring people into your life to support you, mm-hmm. to who hold the vision with you, even if they are just saying that they love you. That instead of the energy moving away from you, it's the energy to build whatever your vision is, mm-hmm. regardless of what your judgment is mm-hmm. of it.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm sure your family's completely transitioned because of what you're doing as well.
Oh my goodness, they totally have. I can't believe it. My dad came with me to Sedona last year on the Juicy Tour, and he spent about 2 weeks with me, and he's transformed.
Oh.
I saw him falling in love. I saw him in tears. Because he came with me to a Hopi ceremony and to meet with the Hopis. I've interviewed them. We went on the first Mesa. It was just, he had read this in books. He was very much in his brain about all of this. And all of a sudden he experienced all of it. And he was just, he's like, my daughter, I'm so proud of you. Oh, my goodness, I had no idea you were doing this. Because he could just see the television or the ego side of it, you know, and he was not seeing the beauty of really the journey on a deeper level. And my mom, same thing. She came with me to Mexico, and she had her own little Juicy Tour.
She's
loving it.
That's great.
She's loving it.
So if people could assist you in any way, like you've assisted them, how would they assist you? Just by going to the website? What would be helpful for you?
Yeah, the best is to spread those videos and to really just go on YouTube, and you type in my name or your, the topic that you have in mind that you're looking for. And I have 1,800 videos over. So there's pretty much every topic, a lot of topics I've covered. So you'll find a video and then you can share that with your friends. That's what I love about the Facebook and the Twitter, because it goes very fast. This story of Anita Moriani, please just, her last name is Moorgani, and you look for that story and listen to it and share that with friends. This is very much a beautiful story.
Mm-hmm.
And to share that, and for the people that want to donate, this is how the tour works. I work, it's donations. Mm-hmm. and all the supportive suggestions and what have you, whatever your heart feels like could contribute.
Great. Well, you can check out her website, which is www.lilumasay.com, and check it out. And really, if you're inspired, do something. Spread the word. Donate, you know, enjoy it, like really feel it and take it in, and you'll get to really feel who Lilo is.
Thank you.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for being with us. It's just been great to have you, and look forward to seeing you on the island.
Thank you.
It feels like a place you're going to keep coming back.
It's home. And back. It's a home, definitely.
All right.
Feels good to my soul. It's nourished here.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.